everybody. I'm really glad to see so many people here. Either you are here because you recognize we have the most serious issue of our time we are faced with right now, or you're here because we need extra credit. But either way, you may not even realize how important it is that you're here and that you are in a position that you can do something about climate change. But can you really do something about climate change? Little things that you can do, right? We can all do little things like what? Use less electricity, use less gasoline, buy secondhand things. There's all sorts of things that you can do as an individual to help reduce climate change. But there's something even more important that you can do. You can get together with a group of people because we is much more powerful than you. And we have Dr. Dan Dieterich here today. He is going to tell us about Citizens Climate Lobby, which is a big movement across North America.
The world.
The world. And what it is getting people together to lobby for legislation that can help mitigate the effects of climate change. So to tell you a little bit about Dan, he's Professor Emeritus from the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point, which means that he is retired after 35 years of writing, editing, and publishing. He's also the leader of the Stevens Point chapter of Citizens Climate Lobby and Citizens Climate Lobby Wisconsin Coordinator, so he is the statewide coordinator. He is an environmentalist. He's the co-founder and president of the Interfaith Community for the Earth, a co-founder and past president of the Central Wisconsin Chapter of Wild Ones, which is for native plants and natural landscapes, which is also something you can do for climate change. And he's also an active member of 350 Stevens Point and the editor of Faith-Based Statements on Climate Change. So please welcome Dr. Dieterich.
Thank you very much. And thank you all for being here. I'm delighted to be able to talk to you today, and I'm also glad that so many of you showed up. It would have been lonely without you. We're going to talk about what you can do about climate change and see where we go with this. First of all, over 97% of climate scientists worldwide are convinced, based upon the evidence, that human-caused climate change is happening. This, according to some studies, the lowest number I've seen is 97%, and the highest number I've seen is 99.9%. There are a few who contradict it, but there's a consensus worldwide about what's going on with climate. Since many of you are in Professor Faust Davis's class, I was wondering if you'd tell me what's causing our climate to change. What is making it change? Why isn't it the way it's always been, or at least has been for centuries? Why is it changing? Yes, sir?
There's a lot of carbon in the air as well as methane.
Okay, there's methane in the air and there's carbon dioxide in the air. And so what?
So that traps the insulation or solar rays that come in and they can't get out. It makes it warm.
Exactly. So it's greenhouse gases, they're called, because it's like a greenhouse which traps the heat on our planet. And there are a number of those greenhouse gases. The one that's most concerning to scientists is carbon dioxide, which is a little strange when you think about it, since methane traps many times more, or is much more damaging to the atmosphere, traps much more heat than does carbon dioxide. But the thing about methane is it goes away in a few years. And carbon dioxide is going to be here for centuries. Centuries it's going to be in the atmosphere. So over the long haul, much more damaging in terms of trapping the heat and keeping it in. The way this thing works is that we have a natural greenhouse effect. By the way, I'm not opposed to carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is our friend. If we didn't have carbon dioxide, we'd all be dead. Our planet would be so cold that it wouldn't sustain human or other forms of life. But the fact of the matter is, we have too much carbon dioxide. The natural greenhouse effect increases the Earth's temperature by around 70 degrees Fahrenheit. And since the average temperature of the planet is something like 54 degrees, that means that without that natural layer, we're in trouble. But we've done something to add to it. We are burning gas, oil, and coal. And the carbon that we release from these, what are called fossil fuels, is released into the atmosphere as carbon dioxide, CO2. And that, along with the other greenhouse gases, is trapping the heat and not allowing it to escape. A lot of the heat is sunk in the oceans, and we might go, that's wonderful, but it's not going to stay sunk forever. And we also have a lot in the atmosphere. So that's what the problem is. There's no scientific debate about this. There may be a debate among other people, but not among scientists. Worldwide, they agree. This is a little graph showing the changes in our carbon dioxide levels on the planet. They take ice cores in the Arctic and the Antarctic. They take ice cores and they examine how much CO2 is there. And as you can see, going back 400,000 years, and actually a lot farther than that, the highest historical levels are under 300 ppm, parts per million, of carbon dioxide. And that takes us up to 1950. And in 1950, you see that spike. And that spike, by the way, is not accurate. It's not tall enough, because it looks like it's about 390 parts per million of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And today, it's well over 400 parts per million in the atmosphere. So there's a lot more carbon getting into our atmosphere. And this also was an incorrect graph, because it says that the warmest year on record is 2014, and that's not true, is it? What's the warmest year? By the way, it was the warmest year on record in 2015. By that time, they said, oh yes, 2014, warmest year on record. What was the next warmest year on record? 2015 was the next warmest year on record. And what was the next warmest year on record? 2016 would be, yeah. So we've had 3 years in a row where the worldwide temperature every year has gone up to become the world's record. So it is getting a lot warmer all over the world, and that includes in the US. You can see this graph here that goes back to 1880. Why does it go to 1880? Well, a couple of reasons. One is that's about the time they started having accurate measurement of warmth in the atmosphere. They started having thermometers that were good enough they could accurately measure things and say what the temperatures around the world were. The other thing that happened around the 1800s, early 1800s, is the Industrial Revolution. That's when we began burning a lot of coal and oil and gas and pumping it into the atmosphere. So since then, you can see the linear trend of rising temperature is going up to the present. So what? So it's getting warmer. Noticing when I came into Oshkosh, I'm from Stevens Point, and the spring is earlier here. You have your trees in full bud, and in my house, no trees are in full bud at the moment. We do have a couple of crocuses, but that's about it. No, not much showing as a result of spring, but it is here. So you have an earlier spring, but what's going on is the whole world is having an earlier spring. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with having a summer that's a few degrees warmer, with a spring that's a little earlier? What's the problem with that? Yes?
It's throwing off the wildlife and its natural cycles.
It's throwing off the natural cycles of the wildlife. So that, want to give me an example?
When different species come out, that depend on each other.
Okay. So when the apple trees come into bloom, there had better be some pollinators around, right? So that those apple trees will bear apples. And what's happening is there aren't, for whatever reason, because of the changes in the cycles, there aren't pollinators there. Snowshoe hare, I don't know, see any snowshoe hares around here? They were around here once upon a time, but they've been moving north. Actually, the snowshoe hares haven't been moving at all. They've been dying. And they've been measuring where they are and what the southernmost point is in Wisconsin of snowshoe hares, and it's going north at a very regular pace in the last several years. So that's going on. Anything else besides the wildlife? You've got those polar bears out in those icebergs, but a lot of people don't much care. So what else is going on besides the wildlife? Yeah?
Rising sea levels.
The sea levels are going up. Wait a second, I thought we were talking about warming. What does that have to do with sea levels?
It's melting ice reserves.
Ice is melting. Ice where? One question for you, you may know the answer, but can anybody tell me how much the oceans would rise if all of the ice in the Arctic melted? Yes?
Was it like
10
feet?
No. Thank you for guessing. I appreciate that. If the Arctic melts, the ocean levels will rise not at all. Why is that? Because the Arctic is not on land. It's on water. And when you put an ice cube into a glass of water and the ice cube melts, the water doesn't overflow on the glass of water. So it's when ice is melting over water, not much of a problem. When it's melting over land, the Antarctic, 10 feet. If the West Antarctic ice sheet melts, and some scientists are saying it's unstoppable at this point, it's past what we call a tipping point, it's going to melt, then this century this could be another 10 feet. If the ice on Greenland melts, and scientists are saying it's melting quite a bit already, but if it all melts, the oceans are going to rise additional tens of feet. So, if it's over land, there's going to be sea rise. Who cares about the sea rising? Well, there are going to be people who are going to die as a result of that. Bangladesh is one of the countries that is already having problems as a result of this. You may not have any friends in Bangladesh, but I have one or two. And they're in real trouble as a result of this. By the way, there is a chapter of Citizens Climate Lobby in Bangladesh. There are chapters all over the world because people all over the world are realizing what's going on and they're trying to deal with it. So ocean levels are going to rise. What else is going to happen besides the oceans getting higher? Yes, sir?
The acidity is going up.
The acidity of the ocean is going up. Why? Carbonic acid. Carbon dioxide in the water, carbonic acid. So the ocean's getting more acidic. Who cares? What difference does it make? Coral bleaching may be somewhat augmented by that, but a lot of the coral bleaching is just simply due to the heat. The oceans are getting hotter, and coral can't live in that kind of situation, so a lot of it's just due to the heat. What else is happening as a result of the acidic oceans? Does anybody know?
Fish kills.
Fish kills?
Like the shells, they can't build their shells.
It's the shellfish that are being in real trouble. Clam harvesters, the oysters, they're putting out their little seedlings and coming back and there's nothing there. It melts the shells. It's that acidic. So that's going to happen, which would affect us quite directly. Anything else? Let's put the oceans aside for a second. What else is the problem? Yes?
Drastic change in weather patterns and natural disasters.
More natural disasters. Why does that happen? Just because it's a little warmer, we have bigger, longer, nastier storms? Why? She mentioned I'm a professor emeritus, and I am from the English department at the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point. But there's one relationship that I know of that I'm just very proud of myself that I know of it. It's called the Clausius-Clapeyron relationship. You can memorize this and amaze your friends. The Clausius-Clapeyron relationship. Clausius was a German scientist. He was a physicist. Clapeyron was a French physicist. And the two of them together did some experiments. This was like 1850-something that their results were published, the two of them. And what they found is if you raise the temperature in the atmosphere 1 degree Celsius, 1 degree, there will be approximately 8% more moisture in the atmosphere. 8% more moisture with 1 degree rise in temperature. So that's the Clausius-Clapeyron relationship. What does it mean? It means there's a heck of a lot more moisture in the atmosphere than there used to be. And therefore, when the water hits a front of some sort, there's either a lot of rain or a lot of snow. It can work either way. So we're going to get really fierce snowstorms in Wisconsin. We're going to get really fierce rainstorms in Wisconsin. And what's the problem with that? So we get a lot of rain. How many of you know what happened in July, this past July, in northwestern Wisconsin. As I recall, it was 8 different counties.
There was a big flooding.
Big flood. Yes?
Roads and bridges collapsed.
Roads, bridges, culverts washed away by this flood. Putting a price tag on that, it would be about how much? About $28 million worth of damage was done. And many highways were out, roads were out for months as a result of this thing. Oh yeah, and by the way, five people died. 350 homes were damaged. It was a disaster. It was a 1,000-year flood. A 1,000-year flood in northwestern Wisconsin, in those counties and the Indian reservation there. 1,000 years doesn't mean it happens once every 1,000 years. What it means is that the chances of having a flood of that magnitude, that big a flood, that much rain, in any given year wasn't 1%, it was 1/10 of 1%. And we're going to have more 1,000-year floods in Wisconsin, as a matter of fact, and they're not going to happen every 1,000 years from now on. They're going to be more frequent. We also had flooding in southwestern Wisconsin. I think it was 8 counties there. Adams, and then to the south and west of that, there was flooding, which also killed 2 people and was a disaster area. That happened in September. One was in July, the other one was in September. So we're going to get more floods. We're going to get more big storms, large storms. It's going to affect agriculture. It's going to affect businesses. It's going to affect transportation. It's going to have a large economic effect and a large social effect here in the state of Wisconsin. So those are just some of the impacts of climate change. So it's not just the polar bears. I just want to stress this. This is something people all over the world are going to suffer from. There are going to be mass migrations, including mass migrations, I believe, in the United States of America. And they're going to happen here because of mega droughts. You may never have heard of the term. It was NOAA and NASA this past year, along with Stanford University, that did some studies and found out that by 2050, there are going to be mega droughts in the U.S. California had a drought. It lasted about 6 years. That's a pretty big drought for any place, as you may have recalled, with the impact it had on California. But these droughts are going to go on for 30 to 35 years. Not 5, 6, but 30 to 35 years. And they're going to hit the Southwest, and they're going to hit the prairie states. Oklahoma, Kansas, New Mexico, Texas, that whole area is going to be hit by droughts lasting 30 to 35 years. And again, you might go, so what? We're not in the prairie states, we're not in the Southwest, we're fine. But those people are going to be in a situation where they can't survive there. And my theory is they're going to move. And if I were them, I'd move to Wisconsin. So I think there are going to be millions of people moving from the Southwest and the prairie states to the north, and that includes Wisconsin. And that's going to have a tremendous impact on this state, the people of the state, as well as on the people who are going to be suffering from the drought and have to move. So these are some of the things going on as a result of climate change. What are you doing about it? Well, Professor Foust Davis already mentioned some things we can do. We can recycle. We can drive fuel-efficient cars. We can do various things as individuals. And I'm not knocking any of those. They are important things to do. They are necessary things to do. But they are just not sufficient things to do. The problem we're facing, which is the threat to human survival, by the way, as well as to the survival of half the animals on the planet. A lot of people are talking about this as the start of the 6th extinction. This is the first one that was caused by human beings, but 6th extinction. Good book by that name out if you want to check it out sometime. But we can do certain things as individuals, but that's not sufficient. We have to work collectively because of the size of the problem. What does collectively mean? It means national action and international action. The international action happened, as I recall, at the Paris Climate Conference. And there were agreements made by countries all over the world. There is now consideration by the United States administration of canceling our agreement, part of that agreement, and not abiding by it. EPA administrator and the president are both in favor of doing that. We're going to see what happens in the future. Nothing has happened yet, but that's an international thing. And there are also national things to do. And we in Citizens Climate Lobby are very much involved with the national things to do. So, whoops. There it is. We are a nonprofit organization. We are a nonpartisan organization. We don't support candidates in either party. Even if members of our organization run for office, we can't support them. We are a grassroots organization. Each chapter, I'm from the Stevens Point chapter, and each chapter runs itself. We have some guidance and support from our national office, but each chapter runs itself, decides what it's going to do. We have chapters in over 350, which is over 80% of US congressional districts, as well as in a number of other countries. Again, the one that fascinates me is Nepal. We have a Citizens Climate Lobby chapter in Nepal, and you might say to yourself, Nepal? Kathmandu, Nepal, why did they have a chapter? Where do you suppose the people in Kathmandu, Nepal, get their water from? Mountain?
Snow melt.
Snow melt and glaciers, right? That's where they get their water from. And guess what's happening to the great glaciers? They're going away in Kathmandu, Nepal. So where are they going to get their water from? They don't adjust, abut any oceans, so yeah, they've got problems. So a number of other countries are involved with Citizens Climate Lobby. Here's some information about us. This is our 10th anniversary. We're a very young organization. It was founded in October of 2007. We have 58,000 members. We have 400 chapters, 20 of them in Wisconsin. And we are a very fast-growing organization. The idea is to empower citizens like us to exercise our political power and get Congress to pass revenue-neutral carbon fee and dividend. Revenue-neutral carbon fee and dividend. More about which in a moment. So our goal is to pass that in 2017, this year. Our goal is to pass this year. Our mission is create the political will for a livable world. Politicians don't create political will. You and I do that. We, the citizens, decide what we want to have happen, and we influence our legislators to bring that about. We bring it about by voting. We bring it about by writing letters to them or publishing things in the newspaper. We demonstrate our political will in a variety of ways. We in Citizens Climate Lobby actually lobby members of Congress. This June, I will be joining 899 other people in Washington, D.C. to lobby our members of Congress about climate change. I have a very specific number there because this past week, we cut off the number of people who can join us in Washington in lobbying. We cut her off at 900. That was as many as we could accommodate, make groups to go and meet with our members of Congress. So, goal is let them know there's some political will out there. We try to empower individuals to make breakthroughs in their personal lives and in their political lives. The idea is you are more powerful than you know. You can shape the future of this planet. And it is possible, by the way, to do that, and it is possible to deal constructively with climate change. It's not something that's beyond our scope. We know what to do and we know how to do it. So we try to empower people. We try to step outside our comfort zone because that's where the magic happens. Before I joined this organization, I had never before lobbied anybody about anything. And I have now done it frequently. I lobbied my member of Congress, as a matter of fact, this past week. Last week, I spoke with Congressman Ron Kind and attempted to persuade him to do some things. So I had never done it before. It wasn't comfortable for me the first time I did it, but to get good things done, you have to step outside your comfort zone. We're not against things. We're not out to spread hate. You know, weirdly enough, what happens when we walk into a member of Congress's office, they often will go, "Whew, glad to see you, because I know you're not going to shout at me." There are a lot of environmental groups that go into members of Congress and they shout at them. They say, "You jerk, you idiot, why are you doing this? Why aren't you doing what we want you to do, you moron?" And they don't like that any more than you would like it. So we don't. We're not based on hate, we're actually based on, of all things, love. We work with gratitude, admiration, and respect for everybody we seek to influence. First thing we say when we walk into a member of Congress, whether it be Senator Baldwin or Senator Johnson, we say thank you for your service. We appreciate what you're doing for the state of Wisconsin and the people of the United States. We mention specific things that they've done that we are appreciative about. That goes with their aides too. We are very polite. We are very persistent. We don't go away. This is too important an issue. We are not going to stop on this someday because it's too hard or we don't feel like it today. Yeah? This is a critical issue. We seek and we develop long-term personal relationships with elected officials and their staff. If money wins, we lose. There are tens of millions of dollars being spent on lobbyists by the fossil fuel industry. There's no way we could come close to that. So if money wins, we lose. But we are betting the farm on personal human relationships with members of Congress, which are set up by our volunteers. I'm a volunteer. Everybody in our organization is a volunteer with about a dozen staff members in California who are there solely to support us, to tell us how to do what we want to do. We focus on solutions. We instill hope. There's every reason for hope. There's every reason why that bill should get through Congress this year. And I'll get into that more later. We try to educate people. We have what we call outreach. And this, by the way, is an example of outreach. We talk to people. I'll be doing a program in a week or two for a Rotary Club in Waupaca. So we do a lot of outreach. Last year I did 28 presentations around the state of Wisconsin. We try to reach people and provide them with the facts. We also lobby in Washington, D.C. You may not be able to pick my face out of this crowd. This was the 800 or so people last year who were lobbying there. But we go en masse into Washington, and also go to our members of Congress's office and meet with them in their listening sessions or their town halls. We talk to them as much as we can, and we do it respectfully. We ask them questions. We try to provide them with information they need. We write letters, op-eds, columns, editorial board. We meet with editorial boards. We put things on the radio, on TV, Facebook, Twitter, and we have outreach events like this one. Now let's talk about revenue-neutral carbon fee and dividend. I've got a page here about this if any of you would like to take it. I've got some information about it. But it works like this. What we are proposing to Congress is that we reduce the carbon in our atmosphere by having oil, coal, and gas companies pay a fee when they pull their fossil fuels out of the ground or when they bring them in from another country. Either way, they pay a fee on that. And the idea is first year, they would pay $15 a ton for the carbon that their fossil fuel will release when it's burned into the atmosphere. It's going to release a ton. They pay the federal government $15 for that amount of fuel. That make sense? They're going to pay $15 to the Treasury. That $15 that goes to the Treasury is going to be refunded to U.S. households. 100% of it, this is fudging a little. It's going to cost something for somebody to administer this, to write out the checks, to make sure the oil company or the coal company is providing accurate data. So it's going to cost something, but it's going to be in single digits. And the rest of the money goes to U.S. households. And it goes to the households monthly, according to our proposal. Every month, your household will get a check. One person in your household, you'd get one unit. Two people in your household, you get two units. You got two people and two kids, you get three units. Each kid counts as a half a unit, so you get three units. And that's as high as it goes. If you have four kids, you still get three units. Got six kids, you get three units. But everybody gets the same amount of money. Bill Gates and me and you, we all get the same amount of money per unit in our household. Everybody gets that. The bad news is that the fossil fuel companies then raise their prices. They're not going to eat this fee that they have to pay. So they're going to raise their prices. And therefore, not only is oil and gas going to get more expensive, but so is coffee at Starbucks. Why? Because they have to heat that coffee and they use fossil fuels to get the energy to run the, yeah. So chairs are going to cost more. Carpeting will cost more, you know. Everything you buy almost that's made with fossil fuels is going to cost more. So we're going to have to pay more money. Everything's going to get more expensive. Notice up above there where it says 100% refund of the money from the oil, coal, and gas companies. So that you got that money on a monthly check. Okay, you're going to be getting that money in. And for most Americans, that will pay for the increase in prices. Who won't it pay enough to cover what they're going to spend as a result of this fee? It won't cover it for people who have got two or three SUVs and a yacht and two airplanes. They're going to be spending a lot on fossil fuel, and this is not going to cover it. Who's going to come out ahead? Somebody who bikes to work, who walks to work, who has a little tiny apartment someplace, not a big giant mansion. Those people are going to come out ahead. They're going to get the same amount of money as Bill Gates gets, but that will be more than enough to pay for what they spend on increased costs as a result of this fee. In other words, the ones who benefit the most are the ones who are going to be hurt the most by climate change, which is the poor. There are other groups as well, small children, the elderly, people who are in third world countries like Bangladesh, but nonetheless, for most of us, we'll get enough back to pay for the increased cost. So what does that do? You take it from the coal companies, you give it to the people who spend it to pay for the increase. What's the sense of that? Well, people are going to realize that it's not wise to invest in coal, gas, and oil. Much smarter to invest in solar power, for example, wind power, thermal, geothermal. For that matter, I'm not advocating this, you understand, but nuclear doesn't release a lot of carbon. Releases a lot of radiation. I'm not saying I'm in love with it, but that too is an option. The idea is lower the amount of carbon we put in the atmosphere dramatically. If you want to get people to use less of something, make it more expensive, and people will buy less of it. You'll still be able to buy as much gas as you want. By the way, $15 per ton the first year. Second year is going to be $25, third year $35, $45, $55, $65, $75, $85. Yeah. And you can see what it's going to be 10 years from now, 5 years. You know how high it's going to be. It's going to go up $10 a year. So you can plan. Whoops. So weirdly enough, ExxonMobil is a supporter of carbon fee and dividend. What? Yeah, they want stability. They want to know where things are going to go. By the way, they too can buy plants that manufacture solar collectors if they felt like it, or other things. So they are aware of it. Other companies as well. We'll get into that. But everything goes through. Any questions on how this works so far? Any questions? Yes, sir.
What about say like construction companies, like building infrastructure, yep, that increase taxes on us?
They would have to pay more for their materials. Okay? You'd have to pay more for whatever you use to construct a house, say for example. But the people who are buying the house would have money to pay for it because of their dividends that they receive. You would have money to pay for the materials from the dividends you receive. Yes, sir?
Why is this better than a cap and trade scheme?
That would take a long time to explain. Any of you are heard of a thing called Laudato Si? It's an encyclical put out by the Pope, 2015, June 18th. He doesn't endorse carbon fee and dividend in that encyclical, but he opposes cap and trade. Says it's too easy to work the system. It seems to be, in his view, a way that wealthy people get wealthier. And there's a lot of evidence to support that. And it's also not transparent. This system is transparent. So we'll get into this a little bit more right now. The advantages of carbon fee and dividend are many. One is it's fast. You can put it in place from the time Congress passes the bill. 6 months later, we can be using carbon fee and dividend. It doesn't cost much. Like a Dusky track of expenditures. It's simple, right? Anybody can understand this. Cap and trade, not so simple. Really quite complex. It's scalable. You can build it up. It's predictable. You know where you're going to be in 10 years. And it's international. If we do it, other countries do it. And it involves no EPA regulation. People who are conservative are, in general, opposed to regulation. Don't you tell me how much gas I can buy or how much my gas will cost. Don't you tell me what kind of car I have to have or what I have. They don't like regulation. This doesn't involve any regulation. It accomplishes a lot more than the Clean Power Plan did, which was President Obama's proposal. This would take a lot more carbon out of the atmosphere without any regulations. So these are some of the advantages of this. In 10 years, clean energy is cheaper than carbon-based energy. In 2017, clean energy is cheaper than carbon-based energy in some parts of the United States. It's cheaper for you to put a solar collector on your roof than it is to buy the power from the power company already. And it's only going to become cheaper. When I moved to Wisconsin, which was in 1976, you remember 1976, don't you? Yeah, good year. Anyway, when I moved to Wisconsin, the cost of solar collectors was quite high. You know how much it's dropped since then till today? 99%. Per kilowatt hour, it's dropped 99% cost of a roof-mounted solar collector. So, yeah, it could become cheaper yet in the years to come, thanks to Elon Musk and a lot of other people. Already accounting for it, ExxonMobil, DuPont, Microsoft, Wells Fargo, Walmart, Walt Disney, Chevron, a lot of major companies already accounting for it in their long-range planning. One thing we haven't covered, if we charge more for electricity because the coal, oil, gas is more expensive, we're going to have a product. I make a widget. That widget costs $10, right? But wait, because of the carbon fee, it costs not $10, it costs me as a manufacturer $11. But in Canada, they still make it for $10 because they don't have carbon fee and dividend. I'm in trouble. People are going to be buying widgets from Canada, not from me. Well, we know that. So we try to avoid what's called slippage, people taking their companies and moving them to Canada, or American companies going out of business, or people buying from other places. What we do is we say to people who are manufacturing things all over the world, either you price your carbon, either you do carbon fee and dividend or cap and trade or something, but make your carbon expensive, or else when your product, your widget, your $10 widget crosses the American border, it suddenly costs $11. And that extra dollar goes into the treasury, the US treasury. So unless you in Canada or wherever it might be want to pay that money to the US government, you've got to price your carbon. What's the result of that? Countries price their carbon. They don't want to give the money away to the US, so they're going to put a scheme in of some sort, cap and trade or carbon fee and dividend, and it will balance things out. You got China up there as the example, because for a long time it was the example. We're worried about China. They're not going to do anything if we don't keep our situation the same with carbon. And they will outcompete us. At the moment, China is doing wonderful things in the area of renewable energy. They have enormous resources being devoted to solar, for example. They are shutting down power plants. They are not building the ones they had planned to build when they're fossil fuel plants. Coal, of course, is what they were mainly using, and still are mainly using, but are cutting it back dramatically. And the reason is they want to become the world's leader in renewable energy. I would too if I were them, especially if the competition goes away. British Columbia is another example people point to. In 2008, they established a carbon tax. And it's not the same as the one we're proposing exactly, because instead of giving the money back to the citizens in British Columbia, they instead cut the taxes in British Columbia, and they also provided some support for low-income people so that they could deal with this increased price of energy. People said, do it, but you're going to, people are going to hate this, they're going to fight this, your GDP, your economy in British Columbia is going to go in the toilet. If you want to commit suicide, go ahead. Did it in 2008, started, they had it at $30 a ton for carbon emissions. You have, sell something that's going to emit a ton of carbon, you pay $30 to the British Columbia government. Fuel use went down. Gross domestic product in British Columbia went up. Jobs went up, and there were lots of studies they did, popularity contests. Do you like this thing? Do you hate this thing? What? And the citizens of British Columbia loved it. So it's working elsewhere. It's in Sweden. It's in Norway. It's in a lot of countries all over the world, and it seems to work pretty well. How can you be sure? How do you know that what I'm saying is the truth? Well, there's an outfit called Regional Economic Models Incorporated. It does studies, it does modeling. What would happen if this were to go on, if that were to go on? And so, Citizens Climate Lobby, which had a budget in, I think it was 2014 they actually did this study, had a budget of $1 million. They paid $100,000 to Regional Economic Models to conduct this study and say, if we were going to start this thing, if we were going to go on, we want to know what would be the impact on the economy in the US, not in British Columbia, not in China, here. Will it help us? Will it hurt us? Will we lose jobs? Everybody was saying, yeah, you'll lose a ton of jobs. That's going to kill the economy. So we hired them to find out if that was true. And they did this study. It was a nationwide study. And they did it by regions. They divided the U.S. up into, I think it was 9 regions, and said, will it hurt jobs? Will people lose jobs if we do this? And what they found was 2.8 million new jobs over a 20-year period. 2.8 million new jobs would be caused by this. Why new jobs? We're going to put coal workers out of work, aren't we? Well, yeah. But at the moment, there aren't a lot of coal workers. Most coal is being mined using robots. So there are a few thousand coal miners, but not a lot, and those people are very highly technical skilled people for the most part, and can find jobs elsewhere. Oil, you want to drill an oil well, doesn't that take a lot of people? The answer, it takes a few people to put that hole in the ground, but if you've ever driven through an oil state, you don't see a lot of people clustering around with buckets taking oil. What you see are these little things, I've heard of called mules, there may be other names for them, but they're just going up and down, you know, going up and down. What are they doing? They're pumping oil into a pipeline someplace. But there aren't any people standing around. In the oil industry, and the coal industry, and the gas industry, they're not people intensive. But if you want to have a solar collector on your roof, somebody's going to have to manufacture that. And somebody's going to have to climb up on your roof and put that solar collector up there. And somebody's going to have to monitor it. It takes a lot more people with solar power or with wind power than it does with coal, oil, or gas. So a lot of new jobs. I don't want to say a lot. A million. Couple million, was it 2.8 million? Not a lot. Maybe 1% more jobs. But it's more, not less. It's more in the United States. We will also have those refunds to households increase until they will eventually reach about $400 a month to a typical family of four, two adults, two kids, we're getting about $400 each month, $4,800 a year. That's a lot of money. So it benefits the households, who will then be spending that money and helping the economy with that money. 225,000 lives will be saved with this approach. They divided the U.S. up into regions, and our regions is the east, north, central. And as you can see, we're going to save more lives in our region than in any other region in the United States of America. Why is that? Why do we save so many lives when other regions save fewer lives?
Does the region have Pennsylvania and Ohio?
Yes. No, our region doesn't. It may have Ohio, it certainly doesn't have Pennsylvania. It has Illinois, Minnesota, Indiana, that area. But why are we going to save so many lives? How do we get our energy? How do we get our electricity in Wisconsin? Coal, he said. That's right. We get most of our, not all of it, but most of our energy comes from coal. And of the three fossil fuels, which one has the worst impact on human health? Coal. Why? Because of carbon dioxide? No, it emits all sorts of junk into the atmosphere that we breathe and get killed by it. So we are going to save a lot of lives in Wisconsin and the other east, north, central states. Summary, employment, 2.8 million new jobs. Sharply reduce carbon dioxide emissions. Sharply reduce them, enough to meet the goals set by the Paris Climate Accords. Increase household incomes by thousands of dollars. It saves lives. It puts $1.3 trillion more into the GDP. There is no economic case against carbon fee. Doesn't exist. This is a guy by the name of Scott Nystrom, addressing members of Congress and their staffs. He was the guy who did the study for REMI, Regional Economic Models, Inc. Okay, we are growing in membership. We're growing in published media. We're growing in meetings with members of Congress. We're growing in outreach events. Just in the recent years, again, outreach events, it was from 412 up to 2,328 last year. Published media went down a little bit in 2016. Why? Because we were concentrating on other aspects of what we're trying to do with Congress, face-to-face lobbying and other things. How can we do this, though, with a Congress that is so divided? We have to have members of both parties sign on to carbon fee or dividend, or it isn't going to happen. Raise hands if any of you have ever heard of the Climate Solutions Caucus in the House of Representatives. That's the usual number. Nobody's ever heard of that sucker. This gives me a chance, though, to tell you my favorite math equation. It works like this. 20 minus 5 equals 34 or 36. 20 minus 5 equals 34 or 36. What's the 20? It's the number of members in the House Bipartisan Climate Solution Caucus before the election. They had 20 people. Then they lost 5 after the election. Some people just left. One or two got voted out of office. So they had 15 people, and this is how many they have today. That's, I think, 34. But there's going to be 36 soon. This was a caucus that was set up with the help of Citizens Climate Lobby, a lot of help from Citizens Climate Lobby, but it was set up so that Carlos Curbelo, who is the guy in the far left-hand corner, and Ted Deutch, who is kind of in the middle on the right side there, Ted Deutch, a Republican, a Democrat, they're from a city called Miami. Why do people in Miami care about climate change? That's right. They're going to be underwater. They've already dedicated $400 million to raising the roads in Miami. Doesn't do much to raise those skyscrapers that are right next to the roads. But nonetheless, spending $400 million on that because they can't stop seawater infiltration. They could put up a 20-foot wall and still be seawater infiltration. Why? It's the rock that they're built on. It's very porous. and the water still comes up in the drains. Sunny days, they have floods in their street. So people in Miami were very interested in this. So we worked with those two guys, they got it started. Last year they had 20 members, now they're up to 34, and there are two more members that are gonna be joining that caucus. I can't tell you who they are, but I can tell you, I think one of them is from the state of Wisconsin. If you wanna join this particular caucus, and you're a Republican, you can't do it. If you wanna join it, and you're a Democrat in the House, you can't do it. It's like Noah's Ark, you have to go in two by two. There's always an equal number of Republicans and Democrats on this caucus. And their goal is to get legislation introduced and passed dealing with the crisis of climate change. That's what they're charged themselves to accomplish. How many of you have heard of the Climate Leadership Council? Anybody heard of them? No? This, a month or two ago at most, eight elder conservative statesmen got together and agreed we ought to have what they call a carbon dividend. It's not identical to what the Citizens Climate Lobby is proposing, but it's awful close. They want to charge $40 a ton the first year, and then they want to raise that rate at 2% above inflation for following years. But border adjustment, just like Citizens Climate Lobby has, and 100% of the fee is distributed, but they would distribute it quarterly instead of monthly, which is what we propose. So who came up with this brilliant idea? James Baker is one of the people, Secretary of the Treasury. George Shultz, under Reagan, he was the Secretary of State. He also is a famous economist, ran the economics department at the University of Chicago, which at the time was the world's greatest school of economics. He now is the chair of the Hoover Institution's Shultz-Stevenson Task Force on Energy Policy. So these are top quality people. Greg Mankiw may not be a name you've ever heard of, but he was the chief economic advisor for George W. Bush and others. So, people of enormous prestige in the Republican Party. There's also a resolution that's been introduced, and it was introduced by 17 Republican members of the House, H.R. 195. If left unaddressed, they say, if left unaddressed, the consequences of a changing climate have the potential to adversely impact all Americans. Boy, are they right. So it urges Congress to, quote, create and support economically viable and broadly supported private and public solutions to study and address the causes and effects of climate change. Now, 17 House Republicans are already signatures to that resolution. This is our advisory board. You'll notice George Shultz up there in the upper left-hand corner. Bunch of other people. James Hansen is the nation's leading climate scientist. Catherine Hayhoe works at the Climate Science Center at Texas Tech. Her husband is a fundamentalist minister. She is a fundamentalist and is just a dynamite speaker. She blows your socks off when she speaks about climate change. A lot of other good people. So I'm going to stop it there. Are there questions you have of me about Citizens Climate Lobby? Yes, sir.
So what's the infrastructure to get the refund or the money to the citizens without increasing federal oversight?
There would be an increase in federal oversight. There would be a cost to taking the money from the fossil fuel companies and delivering it to the citizenry. There is a cost involved there, but it is a small cost, certainly a single-digit cost, and the rest of the money goes to the citizens. We do it already with income tax. There's a cost for that being distributed. They have money they get for oil in Alaska. There's a cost to distribute it to all the Alaskan citizens. But it's not a great cost. Other questions? Yes, sir?
Are you receiving like any kind of kickback from anybody besides bigger oil companies?
What?
In terms of like the carbon fee and dividend?
Carbon fee and the carbon fee comes from the oil, gas, and coal companies. Fossil fuel companies are the only ones that provide that, period. Nobody else would put money in the fund. Other questions about this thing? I am not here to terrify you. I am not terrified. I went to a presentation yesterday by a guy, and at the end of the thing, he said, people always ask me, am I scared? And he said, no, he said, I'm not. He said, I had a dream once. And in the dream, there were people from the future who were talking to me. He was a climate activist. He said, people of the future, you know, 30 years from now, 40, 50 years from now, they were talking to me, and I could barely make it out. But what they were saying was, thank you. Thank you for what you've done. We have the power to accomplish wonderful things regarding something as enormous as climate change. We can do this. It's going to take effort. It's going to take some time. We're going to pull this off. And I am optimistic that we can even do it this year. If any of you are interested in Citizens Climate Lobby, come up here on your way out of here. I've got a little thing you can put your name down. We have a chapter here in Oshkosh, but we're looking for leadership for that chapter, looking for members for that chapter. If you would sign up, we'd be delighted to have you.
Any other questions?
I'll be happy to stick around if anybody wants to come on up and talk further. But thank you all for paying attention. Appreciate it.
Thank you.